I call this meeting the Williamsburg James City County School Board to order. 3.01, can I get a certification for closed session, please?
I certify that to the best of each member's knowledge, the Williamsburg James City County School Board, while in closed session, discussed only public business matters lawfully exempted from open meeting requirements as stated in Virginia law, and that only such public matters as were identified in the motion convening the closed meeting were heard, discussed, or considered.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Ms. Erza?
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Ms. Minor?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. Before we move to approval of the agenda, Ms. Erza, could you take the roll, please?
Dr. Beers is absent. Ms. Cook?
Here.
Ms. Hummel?
Here.
Ms. Minor?
Present.
Mrs. Taylor?
Here.
Mrs. Young?
Here.
Mr. Kelly?
Here. Thank you. Dr. Beers had a personal conflict and couldn't make it tonight. Can I get a motion for approval of the agenda, please?
Mr. Chairman, I approve the agenda presented at 4.01.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? It's been moved and seconded for approval of the agenda as presented. Ms. Erza?
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Ms. Minor?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. 5.01, announcement superintendent's report. Dr. Constantino?
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. Good evening, everyone. This evening, I'd like to share with you a project that epitomizes how WJCC teachers connect curriculum to real-world experiences, and how WJCC students want to be a part of the solution when learning about the challenges that others face. This particular project has been spearheaded by the WJCC Teacher of the Year, Sherry Vandegrift. For approximately 2 months, Mrs. Vandegrift's eighth-grade English classes at Berkeley Middle School have been working on text structure and nonfiction characteristics via the study of a nonfiction narrative book entitled A Long Walk to Water. This book chronicles the hardships of two main characters in South Sudan and details how getting good, clean water is a challenge that both characters face, oftentimes leading to sickness and even death. Students were so engaged in the book that student teacher Isaiah Moore had to ask students not to read ahead too far. By reading the book, students learned a great deal about the text structures, and international affairs, but they also learned so much more. Before the book was even finished, students began questioning how South Sudan came to be this way and what they could do to help. Just the type of critical thinking our schools want to foster. The class decided to take action, and they came up with the H2O Project, Hope to Our Sudan. They thought it was important that for our community to see our neighbors' needs as extensions of our own and help in any way we can. Yes, Sudan is a neighbor to these students. The students put together a marketing plan, came up with a class objective, and set a monetary goal of $5,000 for the project. They created informative pamphlets and public service announcement videos to spread the word and to ask people to donate to the cause. Last week, Angelo Maker, one of the Lost Boys of Sudan, visited Mrs. Vandegrift's class and told students about his personal struggles to find clean drinking water in his country. This visit made the story detailed in the book extremely real to students and strengthened their resolve to make a difference and raise funds for clean drinking water in Sudan. These eighth graders decided to work hard, be socially conscious, and use their critical thinking skills to help others. They are very excited about the opportunity to reach out to another part of the world and to have a positive impact. To read more or to donate to the project, visit the Berkeley Middle School website and click on the slide under Latest News. As we close out another school year, I'd like to recognize all of our teachers, just like Mrs. Vandegrift, who who go beyond the state standards and make a lifelong impact on their students. This is just one example of the many great things that happen in our schools every day, and I thank each and every staff member in WJCC Public Schools for their efforts during the 2015-16 school year. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Those are all of my remarks.
Thank you. It's a great story and a great initiative of Mrs. Vandegrift. So, any board members have any announcements?
Well, I'd like to mention that Dr. Constantino and I attended the NAACP Scholarship Awards Ceremony on Saturday afternoon, and then I attended the Williamsburg-James City County Community Scholarship Awards Ceremony on Sunday afternoon, and both of those civic groups have provided more than $90,000 in scholarships to the students of our community. So, and they're supported by businesses and individuals throughout the community, so we're well blessed with that. And an exciting thing is that the Williamsburg Community Scholarship Fund awarded a CTE scholarship for the first time, provided by one of our parents in the community. So that was a great thing.
Thank you. 6.01, board recognitions.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you for allowing us to recognize several individuals this evening before our students begin their summer break. We begin this evening with an oversight from our May recognitions. At your last meeting, the board recognized outstanding volunteers from each of the division's schools. Unfortunately, we missed one of our volunteers, Charlie DuBay. Mr. DuBay, would you please come forward? Mr. DuBay is Jamestown's Outstanding Volunteer of the Year, and we wanted to be sure he was recognized for his contributions to Jamestown High School. Volunteers are paramount to the success of our school division, and we're thankful for what they bring to our students. Thank you. Thank you. Summer residential governor schools provide high school juniors and seniors with intensive educational experiences. Students live on a college or university campus for up to 4 weeks during the summer, and during this time, students are involved in classroom and laboratory work, field studies, research, individual and group project and performances, and seminars with noted scholars and visiting artists. Students, as your name is called, please come forward to be recognized and remain up front for a group photo. Jamestown's Alexandra Solomon will attend the Governor's School French Academy, and Hugo Boleto will attend the German Academy. Also from Jamestown, both Jeffrey Shi and Samantha Zhang will attend the Spanish Academy, and Tiffany Vasco will attend the Latin Academy. Layman Montgomery from Jamestown will attend the Life Sciences and Medicine Academy. And War Hill's Taylor Gardner will attend the Agricultural Academy, and Faith Lovell will attend the Humanities Academy. This last group of students will attend the Visual and Performing Arts Governor's Academy. From Jamestown, attending are Abigail Carter, Eliza Geer, and William Van Dyke. Lafayette's Abigail Bannon and War Hill's Callista Myers will also attend.
Thank you.
have a very tiny one back here.
The WJCC Honors Program offers an opportunity for students to take advantage of demanding curriculum. Students graduating from the program must complete a minimum of 5 advanced placement courses in 3 different content areas, complete a 4-course sequence in 1 global language, design and complete a community service project, and design and complete an in-depth honors project. WJCC is proud to congratulate 5 students for completing these rigorous tasks and graduating with honors. Students, as I call your name and announce your project title, please come forward to be recognized. From Jamestown High School, Tim Felbinger, Williamsburg's first Boy Scout troop, the story of Troop 103, historic Williamsburg, Virginia. Meg Graham, also from Jamestown, her honors project, social skills development for students with intellectual disabilities inside and outside of the classroom, interactions and activities, Every Helping Hand. Meg Graham. Alexandra Kemper, Alexandra's honors project, researching the effectiveness of human papilloma. Oh boy. What's the word?
It's human papilloma virus.
Human papilloma virus.
It's a vaccine.
I studied that too. I apologize. Researching the effect of the human papilloma virus vaccine, Alexandra Kemper. From Lafayette High School, Chandler Charlize Boone. Her honors topic, The Bridge to Beyond, Forming the Foundation of an Authentic Voice for Middle Schoolers and Their Parents. And from War Hill High School, Deepa Gamir. The topic, The Nepalese Education System, Obstacles and Solutions. Chair, this concludes all of our recognitions for this evening.
To say, Dr. Constantino, every time those honors graduates, it's just amazing to me that they're doing that in high school. Yeah. That brings us to 7.01, citizens' comments. We do not have any cards this evening, so we move ahead to 8.01. Can I get a motion for approval of the personnel actions?
Chairman, I move the approval of the personnel actions at 8.01.
Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion? It's been moved and seconded for approval of the personnel actions as presented this evening. Ms. Serza?
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Ms. Hummel?
Aye.
Ms. Miner?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. Thank you. 9.01, VSBA delegate and alternate delegate. Every year at the Virginia School Board Association Conference, they have the delegate assembly, and the chair and the vice chair are submitted as the delegate and the alternate, so that will be on our agenda for approval at the meeting on the 21st. I have to make sure I get that right. Is there any questions about the delegate and the alternate delegate? Okay, 9.02, authorization of signature in absence of division superintendent. Dr. Constantino.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Members of the board, this is a yearly agenda item to authorize both the deputy superintendent and the chief financial officer to sign State Department of Education documents in the absence of the superintendent.
Any questions from any board members about this authorization? It's standard, what we do every year, and typical housekeeping. Okay. 9.03, VHSL memberships, school year 2016-2017. Dr. Constantino.
Mr. Chair, members of the board, each year each of our high schools are required to submit Virginia High School League information, and it must go through the school board approval process, and my recommendation for your ultimate consideration would be to approve the school's participation in VHSL.
Thank you. Any questions from board members?
Just an observation. I was surprised that there was a difference in the offerings between the three high schools. Is that because of student interest or staffing?
Paula is coming to answer that very question. Good evening, Mrs. DePaul.
Good evening. Yes, each individual school, the students actually are the ones that propose the non-athletic clubs and activities. So as you see, depending on what the focus or the interest of the schools and the students within, that's where we have a slight difference.
Also a difference?
True. I think the one difference is girls golf at Jamestown.
But that's just because the other schools don't have the level of interest in the girls' golf team?
I would have to ask Mrs. Swinton and Dr. Carroll and see whether or not that's the case. Jamestown, yeah. I know they've had a girls' golf team for many years, I think.
Right.
So.
Any other questions? Thank you, Mr. Paul. 9.04, 2016-17 Code of Conduct. Dr. Constantino.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. The Code of Conduct is required by the Code of Virginia, Section 22.1-276.01, and must be approved annually by the school board. Mrs. Bourgeois is here this evening to take you through the highlights and answer any questions you might have.
Thank you. Good evening, Mrs. Bourgeois.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, and Dr. Constantino. Thank you for this opportunity to present the 2016-17 Code of Conduct, which is required by the Code of Virginia. It is brought before the school board annually for a review and approval. It was last approved on August 18th of 2015, and the revisions found in this Code of Conduct have been reviewed by our attorney. For the past 3 years, WJCC has utilized a committee approach to revising the Code of Conduct. This committee is comprised of parents and school staff. The committee has met 4 times during the second semester of this school year. The Code of Conduct is organized in 3 sections. The introductory information, which you can find on pages 1-6, the rules and consequences information, which you can find on pages 7-14, and the policies addressing student matters, which are found on pages 14-38. Page 39 is the acknowledgement form that students and parents sign and return to school to verify that they've received a copy of and reviewed the contents of the Code of Conduct. Due to the amount of information included in the code, families do have a week to return this document. They're asked to return most documents the very next day, but we do allow for some additional time. The revisions this year focus primarily on the introductory pages, with a committee goal to make these first pages more welcoming and engaging to families. This has been accomplished by changing the font and the layout, including a letter of welcome from the board chair and the superintendent, expanding the table of contents, which is located on page 5, to make location of information easier to access, and the inclusion of student and parent rights and responsibilities. The next section has the disposition or the consequences. And the disposition of any incident is a decision that our administrators take very seriously. The level system of consequences that is included on page 7 of the WJCC Code of Conduct provides the opportunity for building administrators to carefully consider all of the facts for each individual case and then make a recommendation based on their findings. A majority of our rules have a range that begins with level 1. This level provides a number of intervention possibilities for consideration. The level system also provides for appropriate disposition of the most serious incidents, typically those that are also legal violations. For 2016-17, there is one recommended consequence level change for the rule classroom or school disruption, which is located on page 11. The consequence range for grades K-5 will be adjusted to levels 1 through 4. This aligns with the consequence levels currently in place for grades K-5 for similar rules such as defiance or disrespect, and has been done with input from building-based administrators. Also, as part of the comprehensive approach to student interventions, the Division MTSS team is continuing to build the framework of supports with tiered levels of intervention. This framework is recognized by the Classrooms Not Courtrooms initiative and is fully supported by the Virginia Department of Education. In July, team members will attend the first round of training for restorative practices. The goal is to have a team of certified trainers for the division so that we can present that division-wide. Also in July, a team representing WJCC schools will attend the Virginia Department of Education's Classrooms Not Courtrooms Institute in Richmond. It's a two-day institute. The primary change in the rules section is the layout. The rules are still listed alphabetically, but the chart format has been taken out to increase the readability for those using the code of conduct. The telephone explanation has also been added to the bottom of each page, as you can see beginning on page 9. Previously, this was only included on the last page of the rules. There are two additional rule additions that will be explained in detail later in this evening agendas. In this evening's agenda, in item 11.02, policy JFC, areas of offense and their definition. Finally, there are no revisions at this time to the policies that are included in the code of conduct for reference for our families. As you can imagine, an annual review of a document of this type cannot be done without a great deal of collaboration. I'd like to thank the building staff, committee members, and my staff for their assistance. I'm available for any questions you might have.
Board members have any questions? Ms. Cook?
I just have a comment. Ms. Bourgeois referenced it, but just in terms of how we're structuring these meetings and how the policy committee is doing its work, I just wanted to explain that the policies are now clustered together, and so the order of this is they're connected, but they're in different order on the agenda because of how we've been conducting the business. But as you can see, there are two policies related to this code of conduct that we'll be able to talk about later, but you know, I just wanted to further explain that a little bit.
Any other comments from board members? The web base of this document on the web, is it presented like this on the web in PDF, or is it in a different format on the web? So
it's in PDF.
PDF.
And each family does receive a personal copy. We still print this for every student in the division.
Is that required by the state?
It is not required. It's the way that we ensure everyone has had access to the information.
Thank you.
Thank you for adding the phone.
I see Mr. Thorpe coming to the podium. 9.05, RFP number 1688822, Computer Adaptive Assessment Tool. Dr. Constantino?
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. Far be it from me to squash Mr. Thorpe's enthusiasm. Take it away.
Great. Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Dr. Constantino. I am here to speak to the RFP process that we have and are following to find a computer adaptive assessment tool for our school division. In an effort to better measure student growth and identify individualized learning supports based on assessment outcomes, the division is seeking a computer adaptive assessment tool. Currently, WJCC uses products from Scholastic for mathematics and Voyager for reading to measure growth in reading and math from grades 3 through 10. We would like for our growth assessments to provide our teachers with both reliable data and instructional pathways for each student so that growth can be maximized. This has led us to the RFP process. A request for proposal was issued on March 30, 2016, to assessment tool providers, and vendors had until May 1st to respond to that proposal. Notice of the RFP was posted on James City County Bulletin Board and placed on the James City County and Williamsburg James City County Public Schools websites. The division received responses from four vendors. On May 23rd, three providers, including Northwest Evaluation Association, Renaissance Learning, and Houghton Mifflin Harcourt, were selected to conduct web demonstrations for the RFP selection committee. On June 9th, that's Thursday, the RFP selection and focus group committees will experience live demonstrations from Northwest Evaluation Association and Houghton Mifflin Harcourt. Those are the two finalists on their computer adaptive assessment tools. The following selection criteria were used to evaluate, or continuing to being used to evaluate the computer adaptive tools. First, individualized student growth measurement over time, the ability to inform individualized post-assessment learning, being able to predict future achievement, high quality assessed content, the ability to interface with other tools and programs, and cost. We're looking forward to formally proposing a computer adaptive assessment tool at the June 21st board meeting. Do you have any questions?
Questions from board members?
I have some questions. Ms. Okay. Young? So who will be utilizing this tool? Teachers?
This will be teachers and staff in the upper elementary and middle schools, as well as the teachers of year-long algebra and geometry classes at the high school level.
Will this information be available from one year to the next?
Yes, that's right.
Okay. You already mentioned the other tools. What were the deficiencies of this Scholastic tool?
We found that it was not giving us enough information. We had some input from teachers this year that said that the tool did not give a lot of instructional resources after the assessment, and it didn't correlate highly with the data from our achievement tests, and both of our finalists offer those attributes.
So will anybody else have access to this information? Are parents going to have access to this?
For each of our finalists, there is a parent communication tool both before the assessment and after the assessment as well. And again, it can show growth over time. So the more times that the student takes the test, the more the growth will be evident.
One of the things you mentioned is that after the information is inputted, does it give direction to the teacher which direction they need to go or what they need to go and remediate or to push forward?
Exactly. It's going to provide instructional resources for the individual student, the specific skill and standard, and at that current level. There will be lessons and videos that can supplement the quality instruction that the teacher is giving.
And how is that going to be made available to the student?
The teacher will facilitate that.
In a total classroom? I mean, if it's an individualized program, how does that benefit the other students that don't need that information?
So, great question. Again, the resources that will come post-assessment, they will supplement. They'll be in addition to the instruction of the classroom teacher. So these would be done in learning stations or in small group time of the lesson.
That's what I was looking for.
Great, thanks.
Any other questions from board members? Ms. Cook?
When would you anticipate? anticipate this being used if purchased, starting?
Good question. We'd be starting in the fall of 2016, and we would be training teachers and users how to use the assessment tool in September. And then we would be providing professional learning to our teachers and staff after that for the post-assessment learning.
Other questions from board members? Ms. Hummel?
Is this a one-time $70,000 fee, or is it something we anticipate will be an annual?
That would depend on the finalist. So I can provide that information on the 21st.
And that one more time for me?
Each of the finalists have different price structures. It might be more the first year and then less in the following years.
Are you stating there's going to be a continued cost for the program once one is adopted?
There may be.
Does one of them not have a continued cost?
They both have continuing costs, but they differ.
So when we vote on this, we're also voting on the fact that there's going to be a continued cost?
That will be one of the factors in what we bring to you on the 21st.
Is there currently a continued cost with the product that we're using now?
It's a small continuing cost.
Mine's small.
Yes.
It's less than $5,000.
So is there any cap on the number of students that can be served by this tool?
There's not. There's just a per license, per student fee. The cost is per student.
We approve this on the 21st, but that goes on next year's budget, 2017, so we won't issue the purchase order until
July.
Great. Another concern I have is not necessarily on just on this one, but on some of these procurements that come to us. I'd like to make sure that when we set up the timeline for the procurement, if we want to approve it on the 21st, that the selection is made by the working session, and that all the assessments that need to be done back up to that to support having a selection made by the working meeting. Sometimes I don't want to get in the habit of a preliminary approval and not have the selection made. I'd like to have time to be able to consider that between the two at the working session and between the two meetings. So, Dr. Constantino, just a general comment on
yeah, and I would just and we're fine to do that. There are times when RFPs are opened between meetings, and we would give you a placeholder item. This clearly wasn't one of those, but
right. I'd just like to when we set our RFP schedule up, I'd like to just set it up so that we minimize the number of between the meetings, opening up the final bids and making the selections so that we can have time to review the recommended selection between.
So just one more question.
Sure.
So I understand. On the 21st, you'll come up with this is the vendor we've chosen, and this is the first year's cost and subsequent year's cost. And then do we have time to think about that before the next meeting to vote on it, or
the intention is to vote on it at the next meeting. So when they send us our packet, that the selection will be made with all the consideration materials, including who the top two vendors were, the differences in the cost of those two, and why you chose one versus the other.
That's right.
So you'll have the packet and then the weekend, and then the intention is to approve that on the Tuesday night. So, and that was the genesis of my comment about.
So, can I just ask you a question? Is the $70,000, does that include the per pupil cost?
Yes.
Do you have an estimate of how many students would be using this?
It would be up to 8,000.
So, it would be the majority of our students?
It would be.
And what's the advantage? I mean, I know that teachers need a lot of information, but is this mostly for high school students that will benefit the high school teachers?
The growth assessment is different than achievement assessment. So in an achievement assessment, we see how students are performing against standards or grade-level standards or skills. However, there are many students that are entering the classroom that already have those skills. What we want to see is how students are growing, and this tool will be able to do that.
Be a student's comparison year to year.
That's right.
Topic to topic rather than the pacing guide.
In both of these different venues that you're talking about, how do they show this growth? Do they use a chart? Do they, I mean, is it anecdotal?
They each have different metrics. I'd be happy to share that with you on the 21st if you like.
I'm supposed to vote in this on the 21st, right?
Yes.
If you could include that in the packet, please, that would be helpful.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Any other comments? Thank you, Mr. Thorpe. 9.06, local plan for the gifted 2016 through 2021. Dr. Constantino.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. Local school boards are required by the regulations governing educational services for gifted students to approve a comprehensive plan for the education of gifted learners. And this evening, our coordinator for gifted education, Allison Shepherd, will be here to take you through the proposed revisions to the division's gifted plan. Shepherd.
Good evening, Mr. Chair, school board members, Dr. Constantino. It is a pleasure to be here with you in order to share updated components of the new cycle of the local plan for the gifted. As you are aware, local school boards are required by the regulations governing educational services for gifted students to approve a comprehensive plan for the education of identified gifted learners. Each local plan is a five-year plan, which can be resubmitted at any time during the cycle to begin a new one. The Virginia Department of Education has provided an updated template to aid school divisions with meeting state local plan requirements. The new local plan was redesigned with the Williamsburg-James City County Schools strategic plan in mind, emphasizing our vision of pursuing excellence and championing the success of all students. Language in the local plan also reflects our division goals and priorities. So let's review a timetable. After this evening, you will note there are several important dates coming up, including a window for soliciting community feedback and holding at least two meetings for face-to-face input regarding the local plan. In addition to submitting a local plan approved by the school board, school boards must also submit a plan for technical review on a timetable arranged by the VDOE. So you'll see that Region 2 is scheduled for its review in October, so we used a backward design and created that timeline. It is our intention to return to the first August board meeting to share feedback and any adjustments made to the local plan with you all based on meetings with parents and community members and gifted resource personnel, as well as survey results from the website. We will also look to take a vote on the plan at the second August meeting. So the very first and most important component of a local plan is a division statement of philosophy for the education of gifted students. I would highlight first and foremost that WJCC is committed to excellence in education for students, with all students having the opportunity to be academically challenged. Students of all cultural and socioeconomic backgrounds and linguistic backgrounds are considered for gifted services. There will be more on this particular aspect of the local plan in a later slide. The most exciting components of any local plan are these six priority areas listed on this slide. We are tasked with identifying goals and objectives and ways that we're going to meet them. The following slides will highlight each area separately with what is new in the plan this cycle. The fifth priority area, equitable representation of students, is a newly added requirement of the VDOE template and specifically requires school divisions to identify goals and objectives that address underrepresentation in gifted programs. We are pleased to be able to share a multifaceted strategic approach in this area with you. Let's begin with what's new in the identification process for gifted services. The new components in identification reflect the philosophy that all students will have an equal opportunity to be considered for identification in gifted services, including using those measures that refer students from traditionally underrepresented populations. We currently have just under 1,600 identified gifted students in grades K through 12. The first bullet reflects the expansion of services for students as a result of the revised VDOE template. School divisions are required to identify and serve students K-12. So, in addition to the gifted services that have been in place with specific gifted academic classes in language arts, social studies, and/or mathematics, and students who were formerly identified for those classes, students are now identified at younger grades for general intellectual aptitude enrichment services. The identification criteria used reflect a holistic case study approach. The remaining bullets relate directly to access for students. We will continue to grow our Emerging Scholars Program, a program for students with potential as measured by a nationally normed, culturally neutral assessment tool, but who may lack access, affirmation, or advocates. In 2014, we began this program with 19 identified first graders from 4 voluntary schools. This year, we have 27 students participating from 6 schools, and we anticipate serving 50 students next year across several grade levels at 8 schools. There's much in the research literature about ways to increase diversity in gifted programs. We are committed to a multifaceted approach, including universal screening of all kindergarten students with a culturally neutral measure that will provide a baseline of data on all of our kindergartners. We will also replace a measure at second grade with a culturally neutral one for a follow-up benchmark on student growth. The Twice Exceptional Task Force exists to develop an awareness and understanding of students with disabilities who may be eligible for gifted services and how to meet their unique needs. This is a joint effort between the Office of Special Education and Gifted Education. Task Force members will continue next year to develop modules for staff training, identification measures for gifted education, and family and community support opportunities. Its draft mission statement reads, "The academic, social, and emotional potential of twice exceptional students will be nurtured and supported by families, students, and staff." It's important to develop identification measures that provide ways for students to demonstrate their gifted potential while still receiving services for their identified disability. The next priority area is delivery of service. An important goal is to provide a variety of service delivery models. In order to ensure that we are aligned with the revised VDOE template, we have put in place guidelines for early identification of students for gifted services. We will be continuing to develop a curriculum framework for grades K through 5 for identified gifted students. Cluster grouping for all students is a strategy that limits the range of students any one teacher has. It's a method for providing full-time gifted education services without major budget implications and with potential to raise achievement for all students. The Office of Student Services is also working in collaboration with school performance to plan, implement, and review procedures for both whole grade acceleration and subject-based accelerative options. These fit with the strategic plan's goal number 2, structuring academic programs to meet the differential needs and interests of students. The last bullet, 2 opportunities for high school students. I think it's wonderful kismet or something that we had those wonderful high schoolers here a little bit earlier, and it shows the effort of our staff to support these students. And the summer residential governor schools have programs in everything from humanities and agriculture to visual performing arts to math and science and VIMS and NASA, and the foreign language academies exist in French, German, Japanese, Latin, and Spanish, and we had almost most of those. State and local school divisions now share in the costs. For the summer residential governor's school, our acceptance rate has increased from 7% in 2013 to 75% in 2016. The foreign language academies have seen like increases from 33% in 2013 to 78% just last month. This reflects the committed work on both high school gifted resource personnel and staff to advertise, encourage, support, and nurture students to apply. This priority area clearly places an emphasis on the development and implementation of a consistent curriculum throughout the division, which will provide a framework for more challenging curriculum, including differentiated opportunities in content and process and product according to our students' learning profile, interests, and readiness. Curriculum instruction for identified gifted students will be developed, implemented, and revised that allows for making connections and then going beyond those found in the standards of learning. Enrichment and extensions will be created across content areas. The overriding emphasis of professional development is to build capacity with staff in our buildings. Ongoing professional learning modules will be developed and delivered to a variety of stakeholders that address particular characteristics, needs, nurturing strategies required for gifted learners. They will include twice exceptional learners, gifted students from traditionally underrepresented populations, differentiation strategies, social and emotional needs of gifted learners, parent involvement, etc. To date, 30 elementary classroom teachers have received professional development related to gifted education, and one of our middle schools elected to, focus its year-long professional development on differentiation strategies. We will continue to build capacity with all of our staff and teachers in our buildings. Another component of our professional development is the development and growth of our partnerships with William & Mary Center for Gifted Education. It has been and continues to be an invaluable one. In February, a cohort of 16 of our school teachers, classroom teachers, began the coursework to obtain the add-on gifted endorsement at no cost to them. There are currently 29 teachers in our school division who have the gifted endorsement. By May of 2017, we will have increased our endorsed classroom teachers by 55%. This is the bullet. This is the slide that I mentioned we would be coming back to. Equitable representation of students. This section is new to the state template since November of 2012 and requires school divisions to develop goals and objectives for addressing ways to develop a more diverse group of students identified for gifted services. At this time, we are between 20 and 22% of our identified gifted students are from minority populations. We will be addressing this issue of underrepresentation, starting with professional learning modules related to culturally and linguistically fair identification measures, as well as characteristics of possible giftedness in diverse student populations. As I mentioned earlier, we've started with 30 teachers, and we're just going to keep on going and going and going and add to the wealth of the school division. From a programming standpoint, we will continue to develop and implement strategies that address the myriad variety of populations, students with potential but who lack access, affirmation, and advocates, twice exceptional learners, as well as continuing to build partnerships with William & Mary Center for Gifted Education. They have a two-week residential camp that is named Camp Launch, and we are fortunate to be included in the Virginia School Division's invited to send rising seventh grade students from low socioeconomic status to experience campus life and a STEM academy. These students are invited at no cost to the families or to our school division. To date, 11 students have been invited to attend. An exciting bonus is these students are automatically invited when they're rising eighth graders, and they may become junior counselors at the camp in which they began as seventh graders. And as I mentioned earlier, equitable representation begins with access. From the identification tools we use to the professional training we provide, both in-house and with our partnerships, we are committed to providing multiple gateways. The sixth priority area is the parent and community engagement. The final area addressed in the local plan for the gifted is this parent community engagement piece. In our strategic plan, one priority area is to develop trust and authentic partnerships with families and the broader community. To that extent, the Office of Gifted Education will be working to ever improve what we call customer service. Workshops for parents and high-ability students will be broadened and increased, again, with support from William & Mary Center for Gifted Education. It's become increasingly important to be able to provide our forms and letters in Spanish to our families. It is vital that we get reliable feedback from our families when students are being referred for gifted services. And we will end with where we began, inviting community members to provide input on this local plan for the gifted over the next couple of months. Thank you.
Thank you. Any board members have comments, questions?
I have some questions. Number
Young?
First of all, Camp Launch, how are these 11 students selected?
They are selected. We're given a certain number from the Center for Gifted Education, and their application has certain requirements. The main one has to do with an income level cutoff.
Are there any other qualifications other than
gifted potential? They don't have to be identified gifted, but they have to be students who are deemed to have potential at their middle school, and so the counselors and the principal work together. And then every once in a while we get more applicants than we have slots, and then we go to a committee, but we haven't had to do that recently.
Have you had workshops for parents prior to this time?
Yes.
And how well attended are those?
Sold out, although they're free.
Sold out in numbers?
Yes. So we can accommodate 30 students and all the parents that want to come. So what ends up happening is it's a twofold event where instead of a parent dropping a child off and going running errands, the student does hands-on workshops, often in the STEM field, and then the parents come and have a symposium on a topic that might be of interest to a parent who has a student who may have gifted potential or they're not sure. And so it's a way to support our parents while we're providing hands-on activities and exploratory investigation to the students.
Just one last question. You were talking about culturally responsive identification tools. What are those exactly?
Well, what we need to remember is that while our enrollment is highly white with our minority population, we need to take into account culturally neutral tools. So, for example, the tool that we use for the universal screening at kindergarten, here's one example, there's no language involved. It's a series of patterns and sequencing, so a student can show what he or she knows without having that roadblock or the wall of resistance of the language piece. So we're trying to, we have become increasingly aware of infusing additional tools so that we can look at a holistic case study model for the student and not just one score.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Any other board member comments? Ms. Minor?
I do have a couple of questions. Thank you for the report. That I did take time to read. So the emerging scholars, you said it was at six of our schools this year?
Yes.
Which six schools is it?
Oh, right. You want me to do
I'm
that?
I'm sorry.
We've got...
Which ones? Because that's elementary, so which ones are not participating?
Currently, JBB, Matoka, and... The stress, the pressure.
I'm sorry. That's okay.
Matthew Whaley.
Just send me a note.
Matthew Whaley,
okay.
Thank you for the pause.
All right, that's fine. All right, that was my one question.
I'm sorry, they're the ones that aren't or
not
are?
Not participate. Do not.
Not currently are Matthew Whaley, that's the one I remember now, Matthew Whaley, JBB, and Matoka are not currently participating with emerging scholars.
We're expanding to those in the next year is what you're...
We're expanding to two more schools next year. And
That's really a budgetary issue?
No, it's not. It's a volunteer. Whether it's the right, you know, if a principal feels that that's the program they want to instill at this time, but there's so many initiatives that sometimes it may not be the right time. And so it's available at any time. And we really look at it as a community-based, as in the school really embracing the program. It's not a gifted program. We just help get it started.
The youngest.
Yes.
The other question I had is, what is the intervention for an underachieving gifted student in the middle and high school?
That's a tough one. That is that's a tough hurdle. I'd be more than happy to put together some background information for you and forward it to the board.
I just have one more question about Camp Launch. What percentage can you tell us who is participating? How many black students, how many Hispanic students are participating?
We have four who are participating, but because I'm not a part of the selection process at the school level, I'd have to get back to you on that, but I'd be more than happy to do that.
But this is for minority students?
It's for students from low socioeconomic.
Okay, so low income, so
yes.
It could be any number of
yes,
students.
Yes, ma'am. Mm-hmm.
Okay, but I would be interested in how that was broke down.
I'd to get that for
Mrs. Hummel.
Thanks for the report. I had just a question, if you could explain the delivery method of cluster grouping.
Absolutely. Cluster grouping, as I said, is a budget-friendly way to provide narrow the continuum of the students that are in any one classroom. And so what it ends up showing is that the teachers have, instead of one of everything, they have a range of students, and you have an opportunity. There are gifted clusters, and then there are classes that don't have gifted clusters, but you have above average students, and they have the opportunity to come to, you know, rise to the front and become the stars in their classroom. And it allows all students to be purposely placed in a classroom based on their abilities, potential, or achievement. And I've been working with elementary principals and some teachers on how to use different data points to help make those placement decisions, not only just based on our reading level, but also how did they do on this more culturally neutral, nationally normed assessment tool. And so that's a little bit about the cluster grouping. Does that help? Okay.
And then my other question was about the applications for the summer governor's school. And you said they went, the acceptance rates went up from 7% to 75%. And I was wondering if there was any difference in the number of applications that were received, because if you had less applications, then maybe your acceptance rate goes up.
Actually, strangely, we're really consistent. In 13-14, we had 15 total summer residential. This year, we had 12. For the foreign language in 13-14, we had 15, and this year we had 9. 14-15, it was 11 and 14. So there's a little bit of a variance, but I have found over the 11 or 12 years I've been doing this, a statewide decrease in students applying. It has to do technology, the immediacy. I don't want to be away for 4 weeks. I have a job. I want my cell phone. They're not allowed to have a cell phone. You know, there are lots of reasons, family needs of making income, or I want to buy a car. And so there has been a decline over the last, I'd say, 8 years. And the state is always trying to find ways to mitigate that, but I think we're doing pretty well, and the high school staff have really embraced kind of reinvigorating this program, because it is very prestigious for the students who are here. It makes them very competitive for their college application.
It doesn't cost them
anything. It costs them nothing.
Opportunity cost of not making money at a summer job.
Correct. Right.
Thank you. Any board member comments?
I'll make one observation. Children did benefit from attending a governor's school, and while it helped her academically in her college application, the interesting thing is the friendship she made in the governor's school continued through her university time, and they're still providing referrals and job contacts and all kinds of really sort of interesting things. So it provides well beyond the academic. It also provides a career path and some social mentoring kinds of opportunities. It's really sort of interesting how that happened. Just to say. So people should really encourage their youngsters to go for lifelong learning and economic opportunity.
I just wanted to express appreciation for the multiple gateways that you have set up within this plan to gain access to services for kids who need it. So I appreciate that very much.
So on the residential plan, how many weeks are you taking their cell phone away from them?
Four.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's a big ask.
That's in the small print.
4 weeks, not 4 minutes. Yeah.
Are they thinking about changing? It's kind of silly to me that they can't bring their cell phones.
It's the idea to be fully immersed in whatever the program is and to be in the present and the now, as Mrs. Miners is saying, that that's an experience that is sort of a one-in-a-lifetime for some of them, but...
Sorry about that. I think you heard from several board members about the culturally responsive identification tools and, you know, the workshops for the students and parents and making sure that we're reaching all a culturally diverse set of parents and students. Because I think that's a real key to our gifted program and extending that diversity greater than what it is. So, but I am happy to see the acceptance rate for the 7 to 75%. That's a pretty good jump. So, thank you. Any other board member comments? We'll move on. 9.07, Title 1A, 2A, and 3A consolidated federal grant funding application for 2016-17. I see the enthusiastic Mr. Thorpe at the podium. Dr. Constantino?
Moving us along.
Thank you, Mr. Chair and members of the board. Mr. Thorpe has returned this time to discuss the application for Title I, Title II, and Title III. This is a yearly application to access the federal funds, and I know that Mr. Thorpe and members of his staff will take you through this.
Good evening again. The purpose of this agenda item tonight is to present the proposed application for the Consolidated Federal Programs Title I, Title II, and Title III grant for the 2016-2017 school year. Our school division continues to submit a combined application for federal funds for Title I, II, and III. Title I serves to provide personnel and resources that supplement academic programming in qualifying schools. Title II supports training, preparation, and recruitment of highly qualified teachers and leaders. And Title III supports language instruction for students with limited English proficiency. Prior to the development of the grants, Mrs. Burton, coordinator of Title I, and I met with the principal and select teachers from each of the Title I schools in order to solicit programmatic ideas for the next school year. State funding is formula-based and includes factors such as enrollment and free and reduced lunch statistics. While funding formulas allocate the amount that schools receive for elementary schools that are at or above the division average, which is currently 31%, any student is eligible for services based on academic need. In terms of Title I reform efforts, we're working to continue to provide funding to implement education reform and school improvement programs that are based on scientifically based research, provide a continuing source of innovative and educational improvement, meet the educational needs of all students, and develop and implement education programs to improve student achievement and teacher performance. Here we can see a pie chart that shows the Title I budget breakdown, and as you can see, there is a very clear emphasis on the services that are directly supporting students, as well as the personnel that can provide those services. These seven schools in our school division receive services and supports through Title I. All schools use a targeted assistance model with the exception of James River Elementary School, and they use the school-wide delivery model. Our emphasis with Title I planning and delivery continues to be direct services to students, highly trained teachers, effective research-based instructional methods, ongoing professional learning, and parental involvement and home literacy resources. And with all of these, it's our aim to supplement, to add to the quality instruction that students are receiving from their classroom teacher. Title II funds support training, preparation, and recruitment of highly qualified teachers and leaders. And Title II supports the implementation and support for schools that are using data teams. Additionally, Title II funds address a portion of the salaries of our science coordinator. That's 25% of our science coordinator salary, 85% of our secondary math coordinator salary, and 65% of our kindergarten through eighth grade literacy coordinator salary. Title III funds are designed to support language instruction for students with limited English proficiency. Title III finances are also used to provide personnel and materials for summer enrichment program, as well as our parent resource and workshop series, as well as secondary extended learning program, which is an after-school program, and our newcomers academy and verified credit pathway. This is our presentation that we have tonight. Do you have any questions for us?
For any questions for Mr. Thorpe? Ms. Cook?
Mr. Thorpe, I have a question for you. If memory serves, a little while ago, we approved some purchase for use to provide some resources through the Title I work that you do. Can you give us some feedback? I know it's early.
I'm so glad that you asked about that. We actually were able to serve 190 kindergartners through second graders with leveled literacy intervention, and that's a program that usually requires 18 to 20 weeks to see results. Of those 190 students, 61% of them tested out at or above grade level at the end of the school year, and in November they were reading below grade level. So those are great results, and we're looking to continue leveled literacy instruction next year. Thank you.
And related to that, you mentioned I think 31% free and reduced lunch.
Yes.
The list of six schools who are receiving Title I support. If memory serves, that number seems to be both the percentage of free and reduced lunch number kids who are eligible, and then also the number of schools who are receiving Title I seems to over time be growing. Am I imagining that, or are there any trends that you can talk about
Sure.
that we should be aware of?
I know in 2013-2014, our free and reduced meal percentage rate was 27.2%, and then last year, 29.6%, so it's rising. Yes, ma'am.
Any other questions?
Yeah, I do have.
Mrs. Hummel?
Thank you. I have just a question about how the Title I spending gets allocated. So is there a threshold of free and reduced lunch percentage?
I can speak to that. So I'll actually give you a quick overview of what happens once we receive our fixed allocation, once the school division receives our fixed allocation. The division can choose to select schools by one of three ways. That's grade span ranking, rank order, or by division ranking. And what we do is grade span ranking, so we rank by the K to 5 grade span. Then what we do is off the top of that allocation, we do set-asides for parental involvement and program administration. And then the remaining funds are used to determine a per pupil expenditure. And so this figure, along with each school's enrollment and free and reduced meal percentage, provides the school allocations, and each of them is different based on that formula.
We have some schools I'm looking at, in particular our middle schools, where we've got one middle school at 44.2% low income, and then another one at 18%. And so it would seem that the needs of those schools with the higher percentages would be a lot more need for intervention, for support for those schools. And I'm wondering if the percentages were equalized a little more, if that would require a little less of a, all hands on deck support for this school versus evening things out a little bit.
That's a great point. Currently, we continue to prioritize funding and services to address the learning needs at the early levels in elementary schools, and we are seeing successful outcomes because of that. But regardless of what schools are identified to receive Title I services, the allocation from the state is fixed. So any changes that we would make would take away from elementary programming. There simply wouldn't be enough funds to provide a quality program. But considering the middle school, that's something we need to talk about and carefully consider.
Any other comments from board members?
Yes, I have
Mrs. Young.
Question. Mr. Turner, what accountability does the federal government require in return for the funds that we receive?
There is actually a great deal of reporting that's required. Ms. Burton, could you come up and talk? This is Mrs. Burton. She's our Title I coordinator, and she happens to be one of the major reporters.
Sure. Good evening. We have measurable objectives, just like we use for our classroom teachers and students. And so the measurable objectives are set based on the needs assessment that we have. Obviously, we focus on literacy. So we report our results each year in the grant application and give the update to the State Department. Sometimes the data is not in at the time that the grant is, of course, written and due to the State Department. So we will make amendments and add that information in.
So, but I do have a question. When we accept federal funds, we're accepting the mandates that are imposed upon us by the federal government also, aren't we?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Any other comments from board members? Ms. Minor.
One question. So over the past 3-4 years, has the Title I funding been consistent, variable, less?
It is continuing to grow, but relatively level. I know 3 years ago it was $1.3+ million. Then, let me see if we go back here. Great. So 3 years ago was over $1.3 million. Last year, $1.54 million and almost $1.6 million for this school year. So it's steadily increasing, but relatively level.
Sorry.
Sometimes rarely are we funded to meet the need.
Occasionally one.
Mrs. Cook?
Mr. Thorpe, you opened your remarks by talking about how you, the process that you use to solicit feedback from the schools, and I just want to thank you for your commitment to that, because that leads to excellence. So thank you for doing that work, and appreciate it.
Any other comments from board members?
The only other, it was helpful to go through the entire application and understand all that we're doing in the schools. That gave me a better understanding of terminology and also impact in what we're doing. And thank you for asking the question about the literacy program. That's helpful to know that. But thank you for the report. It was most helpful.
Very long application, by the way.
It is a long application.
Thank you. Thank you, Mrs. Burton. 10.01, design progress update on James Blair Middle School. Dr. Constantino.
Mr. Chair, members of the board, throughout the process of the design of the middle school, the board has received periodic updates. And one of those updates is required at the 95% completion. And so our representatives from Waller Todd and Fannie Howie are here. Our good friends, Howard and Mike, are back to give you that 95% completion report and to share some pertinent information with you about design, timeline, and other items.
Chairman, members of the board, and Dr. Constantino, thank you for inviting us to come back tonight. This is our fourth or fifth update on the school design since we started, and we are here to talk about the current status, which, as Dr. Constantino mentioned, we're at about 95% through the design process right now. In front of you is the schedule that we're on right now. Phase 1A is for the slight renovations to the existing administration annex, the demolition of the main school building, and some modifications to the parking lot. That is ongoing right now. It will be completed in August. Phase 1B is the main building, the design of the new middle school, and we are about 95% through the construction documents. We are due to finish that up on June 15th. At that point, the drawings will be 100%. They go into the Permits and Inspections Office at the City of Williamsburg for permitting. That's about a one-month-long process. The project will go out to bid. It will be advertised around July 1st. Bids will be received around the beginning of August. And the plan is to come back to you at your August board meeting on the 16th with a recommendation of the low bidder, successful low bidder, for the general construction of the main building. So we're on schedule for that, and that all leads us to a construction process of September 2016 through June of 2018 with an opening in September of 2018. The school district did go through a pre-qualification process for general contractors. There are seven selected general contractors who are going to be invited to bid on the project, so it's not going to be a completely open bid to every contractor in Virginia. There was quite a lengthy selection process in order to pre-qualify general contractors. So we're expecting good competitive bid results. School division also went through a value engineering workshop process, which was about a one-week long process. They hired a value engineering team to look at the construction documents when we were at about 75% completed. And value engineering is a process where we go through, and the VE team goes through the entire set of documents. They look at architecture, structure, mechanical, electrical items, and they select items to consider to be eliminated or deleted or modified in the design in order to achieve a more valuable product. It's not necessarily always a cheaper product, but sometimes it's just a more valuable product in the long run for long-term life cycle costing. They generated a list of 85 items to discuss. 48 of those items were evaluated for further consideration. And out of that 48, 22 were put to the test to find out the value, and it equaled about $850,000 in savings to the project on the 22 items that were selected. The following slide is a list of those 22 items. I'm not going to sit here and go through them all, but it's in your packet if you're interested to see some of the items that were eliminated from the project or modified for the project. One other method to help reduce the cost of the project was an academic analysis was performed after the VE was completed. We went back and looked at program spaces. We looked at the number of classrooms, the sizes of classrooms, the number of resource rooms, all the way through the building, and we reanalyzed the project, and we reduced the building by about 13,000 square feet. At an average cost of our building at about $200 a square foot, that equated to about a $2.6 million cost savings by reducing square footage. None of that square footage was reduced. That had no ill effect on program requirements. We made sure we met with the academic leaders through the school district, so no program modifications were necessary in order to do that. We also had a review by the Department of Education in Richmond. They verified that the building capacity is officially 608 students, and so program capacity was not changed, nor was the program itself as part of this square foot reduction. The site that you're familiar with, Ironbound and Long Hill Road, the intersection where the two meet is undergoing a realignment right now. You can see there's a parking lot in the upper right-hand corner of the site. That's for staff and visitors. The new building is shown in yellow. The existing administration building and annex are the two buildings that are shown to the southeast of that new building, and that's they will remain in place during this process. The parking lot to the south of the annex and the administration building is being improved right now, as you're probably aware. It's being enlarged and improved, and then to the west of the new building is the bus loop. We have a new athletic field. Cooley Field will remain as it is. There's some slight modifications to some of the ancillary buildings around Cooley Field as part of this that will become part of this project. The new entrance for the administration building will be into that south parking lot. There'll be a monument sign placed near the driveway entrance that will identify the entrance into that area to get into the administration building. This view that you see here on the left is the end of that administration building right now. There's some slight modifications there to give it a little bit of identity, a couple of flagpoles, handicapped accessible walkways and ramps going into the building to mark the identification of that building. On the right-hand side, you can see where you enter that building through the double doors coming in from the outside. There is what we'll call a security vestibule where we're creating a new set of double doors so you cannot enter the building and walk down the corridor, similar to the way the building operates right now where you can't get into the building without being brought in by someone with a key card. So when you come into this end of the building, you come into the immediately into that green area, which is a reception and waiting area. And the receptionist will direct you where to go. We'll bring someone down to the reception area to escort you to where you need to be. There's a new conference room that's been created. That's the tan color. And directly across the hall from that is a set of restrooms. That was a public restroom. It was a boys' restroom when it was a school. And we've taken that space and demolished it as a public restroom and created two private restrooms in that area and plus a janitor's closet. So that kind of describes to you what's going on at that end of the administration building. The demolition is about ready to start pretty soon on the main building. That lobby that's out front right now where you come in, that will become out of service very shortly. And with that, I'll turn it over to Michael Hall with Fanning Howie, and he'll run you through the design of the new building.
Thank you, Aaron. Hi, if I haven't met you, I'm Michael Hall, president of Fanning Howie Associates, and we're partnered with Waller Todd. We're educational planning specialists and work all over the country, but I've known Howard for a number of years, and we're good friends, and so we're partnering with him on the educational end of this building. What you're looking at up here are the first floor plan. These are the actual 95% construction documents, so I don't have all the pretty colors on them like I used to, but they're what's being wrapped up to turn into 100% drawings by next Wednesday. You'll see the academic neighborhood up to the top, and the entrance to the building is on the right. The curved element on the first floor is the administrative area, and above that, and I'm going to use another term here, the Research Commons, which we used to know as the Media Center, which we used to know as the library, is now the Research Commons, and it's being outfitted accordingly. The auditoria is right in the middle, so when kids come in from the top of that drawing from the bus loop, they come right into the auditoria, cafetorium, dining space that will be there. And then the gym is off to the left. There's a stage that opens onto the auditoria as well as onto the gym, so we can serve both functions in large gatherings. We have locker rooms that are pretty much similar to what you see over at Hornsby to the far left there. And then down towards the bottom of the sheet, you see the music suite, which is band, vocals, and orchestra all down there, so they can shoot straight across and get up on the stage for production. So all this design work has been vetted with the staff numerous times back and forth, and not just wall locations, but we've also been working with the staff on the furniture, on the equipment, on the electrical outlets, on all the detail that needs to go into the building. This is the second floor, and lower right corner is the Research Commons again. It's on the second floor of this building with probably the seventh grade wing there adjacent to that. And then, on the third floor, we have what will probably be the eighth grade and then some classrooms off of that towards the bottom of the sheet. And this area is where we made some of the modifications in the VE process to get the square footage down to where it fit within our budget. The basic building block of this building, if you haven't seen this, is a neighborhood that is composed of 175 kids, 6 classroom spaces, 1 science space, a collaboration area for kids to be able to, and teachers to be able to open the walls and bring large groups together or small groups or utilize the science facility. There's also a special education room on each floor in each neighborhood, which was vetted with the special ed department. I met with them one day and went through that. In the lower right corner, there's a teacher collaboration space for the teachers on this floor. There's restrooms in here on the left and the right, and there's an exterior exit stair to the back. What we're developing in school design today is what we call a neighborhood perimeter, a secured perimeter, a shelter in place perimeter. So if there's an incident and the building needs to go into lockdown, these 175 kids and their teachers will be in a secured area with secured entrances, with restrooms, with a second exit out of the back of the building, down the stairwell, and out to Ironbound Road, I think. Yeah, it's Ironbound. So this is the building block, and there are three of these, and this gets us up to 608 kids, according to the Department of Education. And then the building can be expanded by another partial wing in the future to pick up the other 300 kids if and when it grows to 900. So that's the basic building block, and then I have some more exciting stuff here to show you. This is an interior rendering looking through the collaboration space to the exterior. You'll see that the lockers are small box lockers. Those are probably going to be wood now. We're still working on those. Classrooms would be on the left and the right with the folding glass walls. I think there was a question about acoustics. The glass wall has the same sound transmission classification as an 8-inch masonry block wall, which you would see at Hornsby, or a double-layered drywall partition with bad insulation in it. It's an STC of 43 to 44, which is what the audiologists recommend for classroom spaces. So despite the concern about the folding walls, they have acoustical seals. At the top and bottom, it's a special acoustical glass that's used. So when you close the doors, you're in another environment. You're not, it's not like your patio door, as an example. It's just another view of that, standing at the windows looking back. There's a projection screen that's on the outside of the science lab there at the far end. And all the furniture in here is movable, and that's the purpose of the collaboration space, is to allow the teachers and allow the students to move things around, to get in small groups, large groups, or individual studies, depending on how they want to do it. The auditoria has a stepped floor that goes down. The stage is at the far end with a curtain. There are movable tables in there. On the left and the right, we are looking at possibly some walls there, folding walls that could close that space in, and a large double folding wall across the back to make it feel more like a black box in the future. And if you look at it standing on the stage, looking back towards the main entrance, there's what we call the gathering stair. It's a large stair with places for kids to sit, to hang out. When they come in from the buses, they can hang in the auditoria or on the gathering stair and be in a secured environment, but be in a kind of a fun environment. That's a close-up of that gathering stair, and the bigger steps are where they can sit and study or do whatever they do, be on their devices in the school. So that's looking out towards the main entry from the edge of the auditorium. The Research Commons is, like I said, what you would know as a library or media center. We've been through several revisions of that design. This is current. We're using low bookshelves everywhere that are on wheels. So other than the bookshelves at the curve, at the exterior wall, under the windows, everything in there is movable. And it will accommodate about 6,500 volumes. We've been through that discussion with the librarian folks at your three other middle schools to get some input on that. So that is all movable furniture. They can arrange it in any, whether they want to do a large group in there or small groups or move all the furniture back and have activities on the floor. It's as flexible as the academic neighborhoods are.
The floor commons?
Yes, I'm sorry. It's two stories. The height in there is about 16 feet to the ceiling, 16, 17. And then there's ductwork and other things up above that. But it's a large, attractive space with a lot of view, basically to the south and to the east is where that curve occurs. So it'll be pretty, and I think we'll have some shades and things in there to cut the sun down if we need to. This is the front elevation, looking at it basically from Long Hill, from kind of the intersection, but you'll see the main entrance there in the middle. The Research Commons off to your left, the academic area is underneath that, under the overhang, and then the academic wings go off to the right in a three-story arrangement. And if and when the building expands, the new wing would be coming straight towards you. It would be to the right of that canopy, and it would slide right in there and connect and bring you right in so that each neighborhood would get another 100 kids in it. So we'd have the 900 total when we're done. And I know there was some concerns about making sure that this worked now in case I am kidnapped by aliens and Howard's retired, that it still will work. And it will. We've got it figured out. The other thing we did, well, I'll get to that in a minute. This is a bird's eye view, and the reason we did this was to kind of give you a feel from a three-dimensional perspective of how the annex relates itself to this building. We have to be at least 30 feet away from the annex buildings for fire code reasons. So we've held that 30-foot perimeter and then shifted the building a little bit so it's kind of wrapped around there. If in the future those two buildings disappear, that is where the new auditorium would come off on the left-hand side, and the new wing would come off the front. So that would complete the design at this point, and then there would be a little bit of change to some of the paving in the future. But that's all been thought through and vetted with staff and administration, and we met with the maintenance people to look at how they get the mechanical equipment, and you know, we've been all around the horn with everybody on the building.
The new wing basically comes off where the, can you back up? Back where the solid brick wall is?
Sorry, I didn't.
The new wing will, where does the new wing back comes off where the solid brick wall is there in the front by the?
Right. It would come off right there. There's a connection that comes back into there, and it would come back through what is now the faculty workrooms, and those would be replaced out in the new wing, and then it would all flow together, so it's one 300-student neighborhood at that point on each floor.
I saw the Q&A slide, so are there any questions from...
Oh, wait, I have my big finish.
I saw the Q&A slide. It's a Q&A.
YouTube.
I'm not sure how to get this. This is the video we did. It's on YouTube. Here we go. If you look up James Blair Middle School, and the guy did its name is Tim Vaughn, V-A-U-G-H-A-N. It's on YouTube right now. See, Howard and I go back to the days when, you know, we had paper to show you and colored drawings, and we're kind of dinosaurs to some of this, but it's very cool what you can do. And you really get a feel then for the exterior appearance. I know we had some discussions about that, as to how Williamsburg-y it needed to get. And so it's got a kind of a wink and a nod towards that, but it's its own building. And this is coming around the locker rooms now and around the bus entrance to the building. This is the kitchen, the mechanical room.
What trees are those?
Yeah.
Barely visible.
This is the locker rooms here, I'm sorry. And now we're to the mechanical room, the kitchen, the service entrance is right here. And now we're coming around to the back canopy where the kids get off the buses and come into the building. And now we're back around looking basically east through the glass ends of the academic section. Okay, big finish, I'm done. Thank you.
Big finish, thank you.
So now I guess we do have Q&A.
Question from board members? Mrs. Cook?
Thank you very much, that's great. I have a question about the value engineering.
Okay.
So I understand that there were 75 items and we got to 22, and I don't want to know what is it, what items are there, but can you help us understand why anything was eliminated from the 85 to the 22, or from the 85 to the 48 to the 22? If you could just give us a sense of
what. The value engineering team was not looking at completed drawings because we hadn't completed drawings yet. So they had made some assumptions that maybe you should do this or maybe you should do that. And some of those were, you're right, we're already doing those. Some of those were, we'll rethink that and look at that again. And we did. Some of the square footage reductions, we had that in process, but we hadn't finalized it. So like reducing the size of the hubs, those reduced, the hubs are those collaboration spaces, by the way. Those also reduced when we reduced the number of classrooms. That shortened the hubs as well, because at one time we had four classrooms on each side of the hub. Now we've got three. So that saved some square footage. They looked at some mechanical and electrical items, you know, different types of systems that we might want to consider, different ways to heat and cool the building. Some of that was okay. Some of it was evaluated and said, no, we don't really want that. They looked at, you know, what we had in terms of floor finishes, and went back to using basically terrazzo everywhere on the first floor in the corridors, but we maybe had too much terrazzo in some of the other areas on the upper floor, so that all got corrected. They looked at some of the site issues, how much paving, where was the paving, can we reduce some paving. That actually played into what I think is a little better solution as you connect the new annex parking lot into this building in the future. The way the loop worked and the way it allowed more green space out there where the baseball field, softball field will be developed. They were, I don't know, I don't even, anything you want to add? It was all over the board, and they're all good suggestions, but some of them just didn't fit into the program, or some of them, you know, had already been considered, but there's a list up there, whatever he showed you that you didn't read, that long list, that was all done. That was all taken into account and took the pricing accordingly. So
I appreciate having the opportunity to gain insight into your thinking. Again, I wasn't necessarily interested in the what as much as I was interested in the why, what your thought process
was.
Well,
and I think I've said this before. All I've ever done is K-12 school design. It's 43 years of this I've done it. You start at a point. You go through staff meetings, and there are wish lists, and you do your best to accommodate those. And then there are maybe some more wish lists. And suddenly, when you thought you were going to be at 108,000, 109,000 square feet, you're at 121,000 square feet, and you know that the budget is fixed. And so you step back and say, okay, we've listened to the staff. We've done the best that we can do, but there's 13,000 square feet here that we cannot afford. So how do we get this back to where it needs to be? And we went through that with the administrative team. And that's why we did an early foray into Richmond with Hunter Barnes and the Department of Education. Say, I'd like you to take our building and do the Department of Ed capacity count for us. And he agreed to do that on a preliminary basis. And, you know, those guys they're pretty sticklers for numbers. And he came back and he said, that building's 608. The way you've redesigned it. So I know we've got the right capacity in the building based on the way Virginia counts it. So it affected architects, it affected structural people, it affected mechanical, electrical, plumbing, site. Everybody had a little bite taken out of them, so that was good.
And everybody who's had a little bite knows that they've had a little bite taken out? Okay.
So that's Howard cracks a whip on them. So, yeah.
Okay. And can you talk a little bit about energy efficiency and what, if any?
We are doing what we call LEED equivalent. We're not doing LEED registered building, but we are using all the LEED sustainable guidelines in the design in terms of heat gain and how you size the mechanical system to deal with that and construction materials and all the LEED water use, all those things are being done as if it were a LEED building, but we're not going through the USGBC's registration program in DC. So you can expect generally on a building that's LEED equivalent that your energy usage is going to be somewhere between 20 and 35% less going through LEED equivalency than just doing maybe a Hornsby-type design and just copying that. This building should be quite a bit less expensive to operate in water, gas, and electric.
Any other comments from board members? Ms. Minor?
Good evening. Thank you for this. You answered a lot of the questions I did have in your presentation, so that was helpful. So are there any things on the horizon in the construction world that might be challenges as we go forward with the bid documents, materials, availability?
Not that I'm aware of right now. I mean, we have been through times in this country and in school construction where right as you go out to bid, the price of structural steel goes through the roof because of the Japanese or whoever they blamed at that period of time.
Whoever it is.
I've been up and down with that. I've been up and down through asphalt's made of oil. And if oil prices shoot up, asphalt prices go up. We haven't seen any spikes in the economy across the country other than normal inflation, and that's all been factored in to the estimating. We haven't seen any big price hikes that we know about. I can't tell you about oil. I don't know what's going to happen in the Middle East.
There was a lot of questions about access and exit for students of disability and with mobilities issues.
Right.
And I think you addressed them prior to me being on the board.
We have the elevator right in the main entrance, and we talked this over with the special ed team when I met with them about special ed rooms on each floor to integrate those kids into the educational environment. But in the case of an emergency, they can't get down the steps maybe as quickly as other kids, so the elevator's right there. And so we can get them down the elevators and get them out of the building. So when I walked them through that, everybody seemed to be fine with that.
Mm-hmm.
Presentation. I just had a question, and I'm sure you guys have thought of it. I just want to make sure for the gym that it's going to accommodate whatever the very, very latest regulations are for
court size,
equipment. All those kind of things that we're running into issues with some of the other schools now.
It's a regulation size court. Number one, it's not an elementary court. It's an 84 foot by 50 foot court. It's got the runouts on either end, and there'll be crash pads on either end. I think when we met with the phys ed people, all the backstops and everything are electronic, so they can fold up. It's got two cross courts, volleyball standards in the floor. It's a wood floor, so. I think we've hit it all, and we've also addressed handicap needs in the locker rooms as well.
Will the ceilings be tall enough for volleyball?
Oh yeah.
How tall?
I think it's
25
foot minimum for volleyball is the minimum standard.
Are middle school gym regulations the same as high school gym regulations?
It depends. Some high schools want a 94-foot court, which is an NBA-length court, so that their kids get used to running 94 feet, so that when the visiting team comes and they're only used to running 84 feet, they get tired quicker.
Well, there you go.
So I've done them both sizes, but that's only at the high school. This is a middle school. This would work in a high school as well. I mean, it's an 84-foot court, which is standard.
Yes, because I mean, we know
the pros and the colleges go to 94, okay. And some high schools where the coaches are fanatics about it. So.
And then this is just kind of a very small question. That conference room for the administration building, is that going to be, this is maybe for the school administrator, is that going to be big enough for us to have work sessions? Since that seems to be...
No, ma'am, that's not your work session room.
Okay.
It's not big enough.
I didn't know.
That conference room is replacing the conference room that's being taken over with the relocation of the HVAC system. So it's just moving from one end of the hallway to the other.
So we won't have something the size of... 400? Okay.
You'll have something close.
Questions from board members?
Thank you very much.
I'm not done yet.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's the board members.
You've got a big finish. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Criteria for pre-qualification of contractors. How do we narrow that down?
Williamsburg Purchasing Department, Williamsburg WJCC Purchasing Department set up the criteria, advertised it, publicly advertised it for contractors to submit their qualifications. We received qualification packages, probably about that thick. Very lengthy process as far as questions, qualifications, sizes of schools that have been done and recently within the last 5 years, similar nature schools, questions about the superintendents that would be assigned, questions about the project managers that would be assigned. It was a pretty thorough review of not only the company history, but also the personnel that might be assigned or that will be assigned to work on this project.
Okay, so we narrowed it down from, do we have any idea of how many submitted to how many?
7 submitted, and they were all qualified. So what that tells us is that the criteria was relatively stringent and that every contractor in town knew that going in. As a matter of fact, I spoke to a contractor who did not submit on it, and they said we couldn't meet the qualifications, so we didn't even bother submitting on it. And this is a contractor that actually builds schools, some elementary schools, but they weren't in the category, the $15 million and up category that was required by this solicitation. So I think just the requirements themselves kind of pre-qualified who was going to submit on it, and the review team looked at all of them, and every firm that submitted was definitely qualified to submit.
Okay, good. Review of drawings, since we're at 95 percentile, I'm assuming that the school system has had a good review of those drawings. Do we have occupants of the building who's eventually going to classroom teachers, and have they had a chance to review the drawings, and are they...
To a certain level, they have. They've actually been involved throughout the design process. As Michael mentioned, a lot of this was vetted out during the design process.
You know how many they's there were?
I might be able to give us a little round, bit of better
round
answer
numbers
on that.
Round numbers are good.
Oh, golly, 30. I mean, we started basically with the curriculum coordinators. Each time we had a specific area we wanted to talk about, and then invited them to involve as many people as they wanted to. So each department from the very beginning had maybe 5 and 10 people, and then it narrowed down when we got to some of the latter stages when we had to get a quicker response.
Okay. So we have had middle school teachers engaged in that review?
I think almost all of them were middle school, because when we picked the curriculum coordinators, that's who they involved. Because I remember in several instances they had a teacher from each of the 3 middle schools in that particular department.
The value engineering workshop items, everybody kind of goes back to value engineering, and in my life, that's where things kind of go bad on occasions, when you start value engineering stuff. So I look at some of these workshop items, use doors and fixed walls in lieu of doors and operable walls. You know, one of the things that we were talking about with this building was the operable walls to expand classrooms bigger or smaller. Where were those value engineered?
Yeah, this plan has obviously changed, but on this drawing, if you look in the lower right classroom above the toilets, you'll see a door, and then you move up a room and there's a door there in a pocket, and you move up to that stair and there's another door up there. And the operable wall operates between that, but we felt it was much less expensive to use a standard door in a pocket and then have the operable wall than to have a door built into the operable wall. You can do it either way, and we've done it both ways, but this was less expensive. And I also tell you from my experience, one of the items in a school that gets used daily are the doors and the hardware. And so this makes it easier to maintain over time the door and the hardware that's going on with it and not have to get into dealing with fixing a door in an operable wall. And it was those kind of things that came up See, some of my folks refer to value engineering as vulture engineering, and you may have heard that, and that's where you go through and pick all the good stuff off the project. And this one did not go that way. It was, some of them were actually cost a little bit more money here and there, but we picked those savings up other places. So I think it was a really good process, and I think you're getting a really good building out of it. I feel good about it.
Go through all these items. I'm not going to. The only one I'm going to go through is single ply roof.
Yeah, that was vetted with the maintenance people. And
how long do we expect that roof to last us?
20 to 30-year roof, I think.
The single ply roof gets me 20 years. I'll be good with that. Classroom count reduced. The education people aren't worried about the classroom count reduced.
We sat in Dr. Constantino's office and went through it in detail.
We had several meetings on that reduction after the value engineering, and brought in curriculum specialists to determine how do we successfully meet our objective and not do anything negatively to impact curriculum. So I think the solutions that we came up with are good solutions, and we still have the classrooms that we need.
I was going to ask you, Doug, is what is a stage proscenium ad auditorium?
Proscenium is the opening. I mean, that's a Latin word. I noticed there were some Latin folks, award winners in here. They would probably understand it.
Yeah, they would know it.
It's the opening, and it's just called a proscenium, and there are different ways to build that, and the value engineering team had some suggestions, which we listened to, and that's been incorporated in the structural drawings. So.
Right. Ms. Hummel?
A question of, are we pretty consistent with our the number of kids per grade level? So you've got your 6th, 7th, 8th graders, and we've got 608.
State counts them in a very consistent fashion.
Okay, so.
So I think it's like 28 in a general classroom, maybe. And then they use a different number for special ed, and it's in their form.
Okay.
And that's why there are 15 different ways to calculate a building capacity. And we kind of got to a point here where we need somebody outside who's got an approval authority to look at it. And so we got a hold of Hunter Barnes at the Department of Ed and submitted the drawings, said, give us the official State of Virginia count on this building. And it's 608. So.
And then you just split it in three, so it's 203 per floor or round?
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah. There are some other classrooms up on the third floor, I think I pointed them out, that add to that count. It's 2 ESL rooms, I think.
And then it's just up to administration if for some reason we have this big birth rate of, you know, we've got a much bigger 6th grade class than we have an 8th grade class, and we...
That's when, yes.
Okay.
The joys of redistricting. Kids don't come in nice even 20.
That's what I was... Well,
no, they don't.
No, it would be nice if they came in bundles of 25 or 30, but that doesn't happen.
Okay.
So generally speaking, I think principals and schedulers are pretty adept at figuring out that. However, should we see some sort of bubble or burst, you know, that would have to be dealt with. And we do have some extra classrooms that we have some flexibility, okay, should that happen.
That's all I've got. Any other board members? 10.02, advisory committee reports. Thank you, gentlemen. I appreciate your input and great work, and looking forward to the next step.
Really excited now.
10.02, advisory committee reports. Dr. Constantino?
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. Per your policy, BCF, advisory committees are appointed by you by October of each school year. The committees are charged to advise the board on various aspects of the division's programs and operations. 21st Century and Career Ready, student advisory and special education advisory committees reports are attached, and I believe two of the committees are here to also, they have the option of giving you a verbal, a summary of their report. and the Special Education and 21st Century Advisory Committee representatives are here to do that this evening. So I don't know if we flipped a coin or you're first.
Anyone who doesn't know me, I'm Christine Tironi with the Special Education Advisory Committee. Thank you for having me. This is my first full year as SEAC chair, so I'm a little bit more knowledgeable than I was the last time I was before you. You all have our report, so I'm not going to run through the tedious bits and pieces of it. There's just a few things that I really wanted to highlight to you. One of the things that we as SEAC continue to struggle with is membership and participation in the committee. There's a lot of hurdles that we have, and so that is something that we need to continue working with. I wanted to mention to you, and Dr. Beers is not here, but I wanted to thank him.
Thank you.
For his help and his ear and his willingness to help us kind of do that. He helped us create a rolling and acceptance for applications. We do have a couple that are coming. So that's been a big thing. That's something that we continue to deal with and are hoping to work with the school division on to change and get communications out. They have been good with helping us, but I think we need to up our game a little bit. I did want to take a moment to let you know that we had some changes this year in our executive committee. We have Chris Wosky. He's the new vice chair. Very excited to have him helping me this year with some of the administrative things to kind of get things off the ground. And again, Jennifer Heidel is our new secretary. So she's on a learning curve on that, but we're good. We're all good. So I've got a good team in place. We intend to spend the summer kind of getting new documents put together and looking at everything and coming up with a real strategic plan on how we can make attendance bigger. We have just three recommendations this year moving forward. And the number one the first recommendation is to hire a behavioral specialist. The district used to have a behavioral specialist on staff. We no longer have one. It was a recommendation and a comment that came from two citizens this year of how valuable that would be to have a behavioral specialist on board for for parents and teachers to be able to refer to when you have children whose issues revolve around their behavior and how we work with that within this district. I know we have a new program that we've implemented, but I think that would be another positive step towards combining these two things and bringing families together and understanding how and what best way to move forward with those kind of situations. The other is, is appropriate assistive technology. We talked about that last year when we talked about specifically about dyslexia. It was a push that we had. I'm grateful that we have an increasing number of teachers within the district who are Wilson trained. It seems to be working. I think at this point we have more students, more need than we have resources, but that's changing and we're eternally grateful for that. One of the places that we are seeing a lapse or a gap, I should say, is we now are teaching children who have difficulties due to dyslexia to read, but what we don't have is a good transition. Okay, you've graduated from this program, now how do we help you? Because simply because you know how to read doesn't mean you read fluently, it doesn't mean that you read quickly, and so the assistive technology is really important to have teachers understand what that assistive technology is, how to access that technology to up our game on technology. How do we get things in a system electronically so it can be best utilized for our students for success? Because we've got very intelligent children who have problems with reading, and it impacts them across all disciplines. And so that's one that we really need to be evaluating. And then the next thing, which I think is the most important, is we as a SEAC, from what my understanding has been, a fairly reactive committee. We see a problem, and we say, you guys are, you know, need to fix this. This is terrible, or whatever. And I know that my team and I would like to say that, yeah, there are times when that's going to happen. We're going to have parents who come against things and say, whoa, this isn't working, and we're going to, you know, say, hey, this isn't working. But we'd like to move from a position of not just that, but to be true collaborators. I know just by chance and by luck, for instance, I'm serving on the 2E task force. I'm a representative of SEAC. It's a vital role for parents and SEAC members to be on committees like this because we have perspective. We've done the research on the legislation, on the needs. We have personal experience, all those kind of things. And we have value add in these processes. And I would invite you and I would invite the district to really consider that and using SEAC as a positive force as we craft our plans, as we craft our buildings, because that's essentially, I think, where our biggest positive impact can be. And so I'd like to see that change. We as a SEAC would like to see that change. And with that, I'll let you all continue your night. So thank you very much. Does anyone have any questions about any? Did you read through it? Did you get a chance? Yeah. It's just all housekeeping, basically. But
any questions from board members or comments?
No, actually, just the one question I had about priorities, recommendation priorities. So thank you for that. Has SEAC taken an active role in doing awareness shops to draw in parents?
We attempted in the fall to do that, and unfortunately we had nobody come. And that's one of our biggest. What we tried to do a workshop on IEPs and how to develop a measurable IEP, and we had no attendees. So we're going to continue to try and do those types of things. We do have speakers at all of our meetings, and we attempt to have speakers that create value and interest and knowledge about resources in the community, the process, all of those kind of things. What I would like to see is actual workshops where people can come and hands-on learn about the process. Because I find that, you know, there's always individual issues, but most of the people that I've talked to, a lot of their frustration falls in the actual process. They don't understand the process, and they get angry at the process. There's assumptions, there's misunderstandings, and I think we as a SEAC need to be part of that solution in educating our parents and our students on what their roles are as advocates for themselves and what the process is so they don't get to a point of frustration and failure. And, of course, then there's always the, you know, fiscal issues and all the other stuff that comes with special ed. But as an advisory committee, I think we could help with that a lot if we can get it off the ground and really get the word out and really use our electronic media to let people know. I know that we have two people right now on the committee who are working on a new brochure that uses different language. We started it, and then it never kind of came to fruition last year, but it will be by the end of the summer. We will have something to present that will have different language that perhaps will attract people to SEAC and understanding what SEAC is and things. I think that's one of a big problem. Teachers don't even know what SEAC is. Ask an entire school of teachers what SEAC is, and they don't know. They don't know. They don't know how it can help their students. They don't know how it can help them. They don't know that they can be part of it. And so that's a huge hurdle that we all have to overcome.
Good.
I just wanted to respond to your recommendation about policy. And I know you're talking about programs as well, but Mrs. Young and I sit on the policy committee. And in response to the experience that I had last year, which was a very positive one, and referring a policy essentially to SEAC. And I know that didn't end up exactly the way that everybody on your committee wanted it, but it did alter what this board ended up taking action on. And so as policies go through that committee, I know we're always looking at it through that lens. And so we appreciate that partnership.
Well, I thank you for saying that. And we appreciate how it went. We would like to have been in the process significantly earlier so that we are part of the drafting of that crafting of that draft. I think that would change things. But we were heard. You heard us. We had supporting documentation and real reasons behind what we were saying, and you all heard us. And that isn't that the important part. We're advising you. You're hearing us, and you did. And so we thank you for that.
Thank you. I appreciate your leadership, and special education community is a very important community to the school system and the school board, I know. And so I appreciate your taking a strategic perspective. As you said, we all know the tactical issues come up, but setting goals and a strategic plan, I think, are key elements of a successful committee, and I appreciate your leadership and energy in that endeavor. So thank you for your efforts. Cool. You're done.
Thank you. Awesome. Good night.
Good evening, members of the board. I'm Brandy Day, and I appreciate the opportunity to speak with you this evening. Dr. Constantino, thank you for the opportunity. I had the privilege this year of chairing the 21st Century and Career Ready Citizen Advisory Committee, and presented the annual report that you have in your board packet this evening, and wanted to highlight some of the information that's included in your report in this presentation. The point of our report and the focus of that is to highlight what our students and teachers accomplished this school year in 2015-2016. So hopefully this will shine a light on the importance of career and technical education in our community. So the CTE program goals are to create a state-of-the-art program for our students to give them practical hands-on experiences, meaningful application of their skills that they are using and learning in the classroom, provide them relevance to their subject area of the courses that they're taking, and give them an open view of what career choices they will have after they graduate high school. And also to provide them industry-based credentials wherever possible if they choose not to pursue the college career route. This year, there were many opportunities for speakers to come in and meet with our students, and you can see here there are two guest speakers that came from James City County, one of whom is a former Lafayette High School student himself. Also, a continuing tradition is the National Manufacturing Day, which we partner with local businesses. Some of those are listed here on the screen. And our students are actually invited into the manufacturing facilities to see the day-to-day work that goes on and how that applies to their education that they're receiving in their CTE curriculum courses that they're taking. We also partner with New Horizons Regional Education Centers, and there were 74 WJCC juniors and seniors who attended 25 different CTE programs this school year in the various different categories that you can see there. So this is obviously applicable to careers in the future. On Tuesday, October 6th, Warhill students were invited to attend the Virginia Workforce Conference. They were one of two schools invited to the conference, and that is to showcase their excellence in STEM program coursework. They listened to remarks by our governor and listened to panel discussions on workforce innovation and redesigning high schools. Warhill students also from Project Lead the Way attended a Capitol Hill student showcase. They were one of 14 invited schools from across the country. This is a huge honor for these students. Oh, the humanity. So this is the 5th annual Society of Naval Architects and Marine Engineers Boat Design Competition. And it's SNAME is what they call it. And that's sponsored by the Newport News Shipbuilding Apprentice School. And Jamestown's team of Oh the Humanity came in second place overall. And the students who were on that team are listed there as well. Over 30 of our students in WJCC participated in that event. They also participated in the Egg Drop Engineering Competition. And our folks from Lafayette, the students there, earned second place in that competition. It is the 5th annual Newport News Shipbuilding Huntington Ingalls Egg Drop Engineering Competition. Our teachers at Jamestown High School were recognized for their financial literacy. They were 46th among the 100 best WISE schools in financial literacy. So we're honoring and recognizing Robin Cornell and Charlotte Stowers. Also, our high schools, all three now, have fully functioning federal credit union partnerships through Bayport. This year, Lafayette and Jamestown opened their student-run credit unions, and War Hill already had theirs, and Williamsburg, James City County is the only school division that has all three of their high schools or all their high schools participating in this partnership. And what it allows the students to do is to actually function in the capacity as a branch teller, utilizing their skill sets that they've learned in class to work in that capacity. The sports marketing classes at Lafayette High School participated in what's called Calls Marketing. They raised money for cancer research in a pink out soccer game where they tie-dyed pink shirts. They sold $376 worth of those and donated that money to cancer research. They also collected food items for the Salvation Food Bank, and they had 4,019 food items that they were able to collect for our local Salvation Army Food Bank. Mr. Adol here is a part of the BA Star Bridging the Gap program. This is a program that our students at Lafayette participate in, and they had 61 computers and 47 printers refurbished and dispersed to community organizations and individuals throughout the community. And Lafayette was one of three schools that received a Best Practices Award from VA Star out of a total of 60 participants. We had career expos for our juniors at all three high schools, and these are the participating employers that attended. And we've got some photos here, and you can see we've got a lot of good employers in our area that are willing to help out and support our students here, and we need to continue to build those relationships. Our students also went to Hampton Convention Center for the Youth Career Expo, in which those seniors and juniors participated in mock interviews. They had their resumes critiqued, and then they received interview feedback on how they can become better interviewers. So where are CTE seniors going to school? These are the lists of accepted universities and their anticipated majors. So you can see that the education that they are receiving in their career and technical education courses are leading them into some of these major anticipated career fields that is a direct correlation to what they're studying here with our CTE teachers. There's also a career readiness certificate that we'd encourage you to look into, and it's supported by the Virginia Workforce Council, the Chamber of Commerce, AFL-CIO, and the Virginia Manufacturers Association. And what this is it certifies employment skills to for multiple industries and companies to demonstrate specific work skills. And they have different levels, bronze, silver, and gold, and that tells the employer that these students have the possession of these skills for 30% of the jobs, 65% of the jobs, or 90% of jobs. So this is another way that our students can go out after college with a certificate in career readiness to let their employers know, I'm ready to take this job. So our recommendations from the 2015-2016 school year are to ensure equitable programming at all of our high schools, establish a CTE course track in middle school by offering the VDOE-approved curriculum career investigation phase one so that the program starts in middle school and continues through high school. Fund the cost for students to obtain that career readiness certification. Research the implementation of a Making Middle Grades Work program to supplement the current interventions that are available for at-risk students. Establish a partnership with Thomas Nelson to develop a CNA training program. This is something that's very needed in this community. We've got a lot of facilities in this community that are going to be needing or already do need certified nursing assistants, and that need is only going to grow. So that is definitely a need that your community has. targeting teacher recruitment efforts to establish succession plan and ensure program continuity and sustain completer courses, allow our students to finish these courses that they've started in that program continuity. Thank you for your time.
Any board members have comments? Go ahead, Mrs. Hummel.
Can you go back to your recommendations?
Sure.
I think this is really important, the ensuring equitable programming at all schools, and I'm really glad that that's one of the advisory committee's major recommendations, number one bullet point. So I really support that. And I also, the last bullet point, I know that this, from what I am hearing from some of our CTE teachers, some of them are retiring, or a lot of them are getting ready to retire. And to replace those teachers is something we, as a division, really need to put a priority on that as well.
Absolutely, and targeting that teacher recruitment at specific universities that produce those types of degrees is very important.
Board member comments? I have to say the some of these CTE programs are some of the most fun ones when you go visit a school to go see. Mr. Adal and the V-Star program, I was just amazed when I walked in there and you see what these students are doing, and then they turn these computers over to people in need, and so they you know, documentation and train them in software, there was so many good lessons learned there by those students. Manufacturing Day, I was amazed at some of the things that I saw in Williamsburg, James City County, as I toured through the manufacturing day. I was like, that's done in James City County? Really? You know, we make that many beer bottles in James City County? So these are really, it's really good work. It really takes a teacher with a passion to get that program off and running. Mr. A at War Hill, and what he has built with Project Lead the Way there. Mr. Adal with the V-Star program, and you really need that teacher with that passion that not only does the program but attracts the students and builds the program, and it's great stuff. And I really enjoy whenever I'm going to the schools and I see those things. So thank you, appreciate that.
I do have one comment with Pathways coming forward and needing more mentorships and support, business support. Is there a way to expand the membership on this committee? Is that something the board needs to consider?
As it is, I don't know how much participation you get, but I don't know, something.
Yeah, that's certainly at the board's pleasure. Not everyone attends every meeting. It's certainly based upon your schedule and availability, but I think it is a very active board and one in which we all reach out to our own connections as well. And I think that the number of employers that attended the events shows the community is involved, but certainly the bigger your network is, the broader your reach will be.
But part of the responsibility of a committee member is not just to his own. If he has a CTE business, was to reach out to other
Absolutely.
CTEs, and if you saw the participation that you got at the career days and also just the manufacturing day. Some of those companies, Apple's 10-year award. Who knew? I mean, it's pretty good stuff. So there's good and bads of expanding the committees. You have quorum issues, and you get more involved, but then sometimes the more involved, you get less involved, and so. But it's something to think about. And so I would welcome your thoughts and perspective on that, as far as expanding it. Thank you.
Thank you.
And the Student Advisory Committee just submitted their report.
I would like to just say that if you look at the committee recommendations that are on the report. One of the things that I discovered working with those students, and admittedly we only met twice, but one of the things that I thought they came up with very good ideas, and one of them was, well, several of them, but one of them was the impact that SOL testing had, being removed from class and then trying to make it work. That was from one of the ninth graders, and I'm sure that she was still learning how to be a high school student. But she seemed to really have an understanding of how that was impacting her learning. And also, if you go down to where it says to request board consideration to expand the student term to 2 years in order to allow for continuity in school representation, it was noted that all other board advisory committee members have a 2-year term. And I think it would be advisable if those could be staggered, like you'd be on you choose half the board 1 year and half the next, so that they would overlap, so that a good part of the board would already be in place and have an understanding of how the board worked.
So you don't spend the first two meetings of the year trying to figure out what you're doing and how you're doing it, right?
Yes, very much. And then, of course, if you look at our schedule, one meeting was canceled due to tornado that didn't like us very much. But I don't know, Holly, do you have any other thing you would like to add to that?
Yeah, the Student Advisory Committee, I've always been amazed at how participative they are, and they don't hold back, and they will certainly tell you what they feel. And so it's
smart kids.
There's some smart, engaged kids, and so I guess we can take a look at that 2-year term and figure out how we would implement that. Something to think about. So. Did you enjoy your time on that committee and with those
loved
students?
I did. It was lots of fun talking to them.
Yeah. Moving on, 11.01, revised policy IGBB programs for gifted students.
Mr. Chair, members of the board, all the three policies that you'll see, of course, have been through the policy subcommittee, and various staff members are here to take you through the changes or answer any questions you might have regarding the policy. And, of course, the policy committee can share their perspective as well. We start with the gifted IGBB, Programs for Gifted Students.
Good evening again.
Good evening.
Mr. Chair, members of the school board, Dr. Constantino, policy code IGBB, Programs for Gifted Students, has been reviewed by our attorney and, of course, by the school board policy subcommittee. This policy was adopted in 1974 and last reviewed in 2001. This policy has been revised with current VSBA policy language. The main changes reflect an update to the policy language to ensure all students have access and opportunity to be considered for gifted programs. In addition, the policy language reflects expanded services to include general intellectual aptitude. In the new policy, language was removed that had to do with the appointment of a local advisory committee based on a change in state requirements. Local school divisions no longer must appoint a gifted advisory committee, so in 2013, the school board elected to not appoint one due to lack of attendance, interest, and participation. Therefore, the language has been removed, but the revised policy references the board policy that guides the identification of advisory committees to the board is included. Any questions?
Questions? They don't have any questions. They were there. They know all that. Thank you. 11.02, revised policy JHCD, administering medication to students.
Mr. Chair, Janice Fowler, our Supervisor of Health Services, is here to take you through those policy changes.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, and Dr. Constantino. Thank you for this opportunity to highlight some revisions suggested to this policy JHCD, administering medications to students. These revisions have been reviewed by our attorney and our school board policy subcommittee for your consideration. There are three major revisions to the policy that was last reviewed and revised in 2006. One, the policy has been reformatted to make information more clear. Two, beginning on line 153, we have modified over-the-counter medication requirements to only require parent permission for the administration of over-the-counter medications during school hours, and this better aligns with the current VSBA model policy. And lastly, beginning on line 194, we have added the language to allow students diagnosed with diabetes with parental permission and written approval from a prescriber to carry and use their diabetes supplies and self-check their blood sugars during school day, on the school bus, and during school-sponsored activities. And this aligns with the current code of Virginia. And I'm happy to answer any questions that you may have.
Question? Ms. Cook?
Just two comments. I think the parental permission for over-the-counter will be met with much appreciation and relief. And then I think, correct me if I'm wrong, but the change for students who are diagnosed with diabetes, that allows them to stay in the class, right?
Absolutely. So. Yes, and as they should be, especially, you know, as long as they're able to do it on their own independently, this is something they're going to be living with for the rest of their lives. So we want them to be in the classroom and be educated and be able to take care of their own needs within the classroom setting. So, and I know our local physicians will be very happy that they no longer have to write a medical order for over-the-counter medications. That will free them up as well. So,
work on this.
Joy and relief from the parental community about over-the-counter medications. Thank you. I appreciate that.
I was just going to ask if there was a typo on line 114. My apologies. It says administration of medication by school board staff.
Yeah, that would be the administration.
Is that correct? Yes. I just want to make sure. Okay, thank you. It's slightly confusing. That wording, because I don't want to administer medication.
Your school board, not school board staff. Thank you. 11.03, Vice Policy JFC, Areas of Offense and Their Definitions.
Here, members of the board, a while ago, we talked about the Code of Conduct, and it's it was going to be impacted by a policy JFC. Ms. Cook mentioned that later in the meeting we would get to that policy. And Dr. Butler is here to take us through the changes and answer any questions you have. Good evening.
Dr. Butler.
Chairman, members of the board, Dr. Constantino, good evening, and thank you for this opportunity to present revisions to policy JFC, areas of offense and their definitions. This policy has been reviewed by the attorney and the school board policy subcommittee as well. The Code of Virginia, section 22.1-252.13, requires local school boards to maintain and follow up-to-date policies. In addition, it requires school boards to annually adopt policies, regulations, and establish rules of conduct for student behavior in order to protect the health, safety, and welfare of all students enrolled in a public school setting. In your information packets this afternoon, you will find a copy of Virginia School Board Association JFC model policy regarding the standards of student conduct. You also find a copy of the draft of the 2016-2017 JFC policy for Williamsburg-Genesee County Public Schools. As stated by Mrs. Bourgeois in her presentation, a committee was formed this year, including parents and school-based personnel and staff in the Office of Student Services to review policy JFC and determine if any revisions were necessary. Based on the feedback from school administrators, there were three revisions that were proposed. The first revision is located on page 4. A new rule was added called medication. In the 2015-2016 JFC policy, a student who has been prescribed medication and have it in their possession, even if they were prescribed by a physician, could face the same consequences as a student with a controlled substance or marijuana under the alcohol and drug rule. Under the existing policy, students would receive or could face a 10-day suspension with a recommendation for long-term suspension for this offense. School-based administrators asked for flexibility in this policy so that they could work with students and families based on the facts and circumstances of that particular situation. This is the reason for this revision and this addition of the medication rule. The second revision is located on page 6. A new rule was called unauthorized property. Currently, if a student possesses a toy or electronic device, there is no specific guidance on how to address this matter in the current student code of conduct. Items such as a plastic sword. Many of our students watch Transformers and different things, and so Optimus Prime has a plastic sword that he uses in the cartoons, and they have it available in Target and other stores. And they happen to leave it in their book bag and bring it to school. School administration is left in a quandary. You know, do they characterize it as a weapon or dangerous item, or is it used for disruptive behavior? And so in order to provide a more appropriate setting in our student code of conduct to address those type of issues, that's the reason why that was asked for and recommended for the revision. The last revision is on page 7. The line strike through that you see on page 7, the very last sentence in the policy, was removed because it was no longer appropriate for that placement because it is currently in the Code of Conduct Handbook. In addition to these things with the revisions that have been proposed, there would be training for school administration and staff on the new rules and also an understanding of why those rules were put in place. At this time, if there are any questions, I'll be more than happy to answer them.
Any board member questions tonight? Any questions? The one question I had on the medication on Part 4.
Yes, sir.
Is there any benefit of putting in there over-the-counter with parent permission? Because we say that students are prohibited from possessing any prescription or non-prescription medication of any kind unless otherwise authorized under policy JHCD. Can we kind of give them the code that if you write a note that over-the-counter is... You know what I'm saying? Instead of making them go look at the policy. Although here she comes.
Aren't the over counter held in the nurse's office?
I think that the current JHCD policy allows for parents to give permission for the administration of over the counter medications during school hours. It doesn't give permission for students to carry it on their person.
Gotcha.
Okay. All right.
Thank you. Never mind.
Okay.
Anybody, any other thing? Anybody want to say something dumb like me? Thank you, Dr. Butler. Appreciate it. So, Janet, can you just help me here? We do not, as far as our agenda goes, we do not have the 9.06 local plan for the gifted 2016-20. We don't approve that at the next meeting, right?
No, we don't have to.
Yeah, as I recall, the presentation, it comes later in August.
Right.
Okay, so this is just on for our information, but it's not going to be.
It'll be removed and come back in August.
Gotcha. Okay. I want to make sure I was catching up. So that finally brings us to board member comments. Are there any comments from any board members this evening? Ms. Taylor?
I'm just excited about my first WJCC graduation coming up, and I know the high school students are too. So I'm ready for that.
Sure. Ms. Meyer?
I'm looking forward to the early college celebration tomorrow evening at Warhill, and then the GED graduation on Thursday evening at Jamestown, and of course graduating all of our seniors on the 18th. It's one of the reasons that we serve on school boards to see the success of our students going forward.
I just wanted to echo the other comments about congratulating our seniors, and I wanted to thank all of the community members who donated their money for the WJCC Scholarship Fund and the NAACP Scholarship Fund. It really, really helps. Just on a personal basis, my daughter got one of those scholarships, and it allowed her to buy a computer to go to school. And it's just a really wonderful gift that the community does to support our graduating seniors. So I just wanted to say that. And then just a general question, do we know what the status is for the RFP for the auxiliary gym? Do we know, like, where that is in the...
I'm sure the administration can update us on at the next meeting.
Okay, sure.
At the
next meeting? I can send you a note.
Thank you.
That's fine. Ms. Young?
Well, I'm just excited for the high school seniors. I'm sure they're dancing off the walls, and their parents are just as excited as they are. But I think it's an exciting time of the year for them and for us to be able to participate, so I am looking forward to it. And for the GED graduation, that is, has to be a highlight. Having had two sons who went the GED route, I'm very excited for those parents. That's quite a milestone to see your child achieve that, because it opens opportunities that they wouldn't have otherwise. And for the celebration, we're going to participate in tomorrow night, so I will be there. I won't be asleep.
Ms. Cook.
I'm sure with all that dancing going on, everybody's following policies.
One would hope.
So I just wanted to make a comment. After the last school board meeting, I read in the local media a statement that this school division had given surveys and not used the results in decision making. And I'd just like to offer a different perspective after having read that. I've been on the school board for a year and a half, and prior to that, I was president of the PTA Council in WJCC. Served on the division strategic planning committee, on multiple calendar committees, among other things. As part of my work in those roles, I've been actively involved in promoting surveys conducted by the division, analyzing those survey results, and using that analysis to inform decision making. It has been my experience that this school division, both the administration and the board, has taken stakeholder input very seriously, without exception. WJC staff has made recommendations. The board has taken votes, and the administration has adjusted its work based on the data revealed in surveys. I look forward to future stakeholder input so this division can continue to serve its constituents as well as it has in the past. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. With it being the end of the school year, I just have a couple of perspectives I want to say. First, on Facebook, I've been following the trials and travails of Gracie, an elementary school student who has faced the battle of leukemia for most of the school year. I want to thank Eric Stone for sharing her story. I also learned today that Gracie actually attends Magruder Elementary, but one of her parents works for the city, another of her parents works for the county, and so I'm going to use that connection to congratulate Gracie on her return to school this week and to thank the students of Magruder for their welcoming her back. I have shed tears and grown smiles as I watched from afar as she fought this disease, and I haven't had the opportunity to meet her, but I hope to one day, and just God bless her on that. So as we approach the end of the school year, I want to acknowledge the teachers, support staff, bus drivers, and all the folks in our school buildings who serve our students so well during the academic year. So often the amazing work you do is not appreciated publicly, and I would like to extend my thanks and the thanks of the school board to each of you. You folks do such good work, and seeing the accomplishments of our students, it does not happen by accident. So on behalf of the board, all the parents and students in WJCC, thank you for all you do. For those employees who are taking a well-deserved summer break, relax, enjoy, be safe, and recharge for next year. I know, personally, that preparation for next year has already begun and continues through the summer. The dedication of teachers is amazing. They don't do it for the money, but for the satisfaction of seeing a light go off in a kid's eyes. For the operations and administration folk, Mr. Sipes, the folks who keep working through the summer, best wishes as you make preparations for the coming year. The administration, like the overhead leadership and management in most organizations, has the reputation of not being highly stressed, but being highly paid. So when you talk to folks that join the administration, you certainly get a different perspective. Grant form, state, federal reporting, understanding of standards, how these standards are implemented, professional development, management of student records, and all the rest of that, those unnecessary evils, are accomplished by an amazingly small number of dedicated employees. And to those folks, I say thank you. To our operations folks who finally get most of the teachers and students out of the way so they can go complete their projects, deep clean our schools, generally get them ready and keep them maintained in the exceptional condition they are in to serve our teachers and students, I would like to extend my thanks on behalf of the school board to those operations teammates who drive our kids to school, feed our kids, make sure the buses and air conditioning work, and keep our buildings humming. So they do great work. I was not able to make the retirement celebration this year, but I would like to extend my thanks and my congratulations to those employees who are entering retirement and the next phase of their life. No matter your role in our school system, you had a significant impact on the lives of our kids. While we're excited for you, we are also a little melancholy as we remember your contributions and your gifts through the years. I'm sure our retirees each have similar thoughts at the end of the school year, as the end of the school year approaches. And on behalf of the board, fair winds and following seas. A little maritime reference, I can't help it. To our students, whose accomplishments and achievements never cease to amaze, congratulations on completing another school year. Enjoy the summer, be safe, and we look forward to seeing you a little tanner and a little taller in September. And no matter what grade you have just completed, it wouldn't hurt you to read a book or two over the summer, just for fun. To our graduates who celebrate their commencement exercises in a few weeks, congratulations and best wishes in your pursuit of your definition of success and your life's dreams. The ceremony is called commencement, to commence, to get started with your next phase in life. You have the skills, show the drive, and continue to amaze us. All our best as you begin our journey. It is also appropriate this time to reflect on our journey this far as a school board. Five of us began their school board service in 2016. One of the five is actually a restart. Retread. We've done some things well, others we could do better. One of the significant measures of an organization is the effectiveness of its leadership. For Williamsburg James City County Schools, that is us. How we do our work matters. If we govern and do our work with consideration and thoughtfulness, the stakeholders, both inside and outside of our organization, will think of this school system as efficient and effective. If we do our work sloppy without appropriate thoughtfulness and with too much haste, a different impression is given to our stakeholders, an impression which is contrary to the good work and results that this school system delivers. We are one of, I think the number is 22 school systems across the entire Commonwealth out of 138 school systems, where every single one of our schools is accredited. That's pretty good, folks. This organization deserves leadership commensurate with our results. I'd also like to thank the many folks, including some who have come to the podium and advocated for the renaming of Rawlsburg Elementary, for understanding and affirming that I did the right thing by abstaining last week at our last meeting. I certainly appreciate and respect your opinions and your affirmation. Further, I want to apologize to the faculty and staff and students of Rawlsburg, who arrived at school on that Wednesday and became aware of the action that this board had taken. The faculty and staff, had to communicate and manage the 600 students who were taken by surprise by our actions, some of which who had to take SOLs that day, some of the students who were moved to tears that their school was going to be renamed. I know this did not make your day any easier, and hopefully the students were able to perform on the SOLs and get through the rest of the day. As we reflect on the first half of the year, let us take stock of what we as board leadership have done well and what we can do better. It's too late. Let's move on. Upcoming events, as you've heard, early college celebration tomorrow at 6 p.m. at War Hill. GED graduation June 9th, that's Thursday, at 6 p.m. at Jamestown High School. NSPA Advocacy Institute 6/12 through 16 in Washington, D.C., which I believe Mrs. Young is attending. The Policy Committee meets 6/14 at 1:30 p.m., TBD, somewhere. Graduations, June 18th, 16, William Mary Hall. We start in the morning, we continue at noon, and we end in the afternoon. So always look forward to graduations and a great day in WJCC. Next meeting, 6/21 at 6 o'clock here in Building F, with closed session, followed by a regular meeting on June 21st at 6:30 here in the boardroom. On July 12th, we have a closed session at 6 o'clock at the Stryker Building in the Council Workroom. And then on July 12th, work session, action item 6:30 at City Council Chambers. So, Mrs. Serza, I think we know what our agenda is for our June 21st meeting. And with that, we are adjourned.